This is Smart Money with Pat Boyle and Julia Anderson.
Thank you for joining us. I'm Pat Boyle along with Julia Anderson, author Julia Anderson. She's written a book called Smart Money, Smart Women, Smart Money, Smart Life. And we're going to talk about it. I've read it. It's great. It's empowering to women and men alike, talking about financing and just taking charge of your future and your investments. And one of the things I want to talk about today, you have a good chapter on this, financial planners. First of all, how do you pick one, and how big of an industry is it? Is it a growing industry?
It's a huge industry. The financial industry, frankly, I think has convinced a lot of us that you cannot handle your investments yourself because it's way too complicated for you. I think a lot of women in particular are very cautious about investing and turn to financial planners for help. A lot of my friends who are in retirement say, well, I've talked to my guy and he says this about this and blah, blah, blah. And so many of us feel we need a financial planner, but there's ways to find a good one.
Well, I know I'll get in the mail, have a steak dinner and hear from a financial planner. I mean, those seem to be a pretty common approach, just kind of cold calls to your mailbox.
Well, if you want the steak dinner, you know, go and take advantage of that, but do not sign up on the dotted line because a lot of them are looking for a commission up front that will come right out of your money.
Ooh. Do you necessarily need a financial planner? Is there any sort of stack? I mean, if this, you probably need one, but if you just have simple investments, you don't. I mean, is there any rule of thumb?
No, I don't think you need one. But I got lucky because my mother, the farm wife, started giving me stock when I was pretty young. And the idea was that I wasn't going to be spending this stock. It was going to be part of my financial long-term investment strategy. Mm-hmm. And so she just would pick a stock here and there that she liked that company. She liked McDonald's, so I don't know, when I was like 34, she gave me 5 shares of McDonald's.
Oh, wow.
So it was all done through, back in the 80s when all that was going on, through a brokerage firm that she had, but she was pretty much making her own decisions, but she did have an advisor. And so I didn't see any big issues around doing that. I learned from her, basically, that this can be fun. If you make mistakes, you can recover. And I learned about stocks and investing in dividends that get paid every quarter, and then you reinvest the dividends and buy more shares in that company. And by the end of her life, my mom had a really nice portfolio, and she did it mostly herself. Now, it's a lot easier to do it yourself because there are online brokerage firms like Fidelity and it's not coming to mind right now.
It's in your book.
There are plenty of them that you can go online for, you know, $1,000. You can start an account and start an IRA or a Roth IRA, either one are tax deferred, mm-hmm. and start building your own portfolio and learn as you go.
One of the things you say in page 71,
yeah,
about financial planners, that men are more likely to switch up if they're not happy with a financial planner, whereas women are more, but they're so nice.
That's it.
So with that, you do have some questions, and this is another empowering thing I found about your book. You have questions to ask when choosing a financial planner, and you advise you don't really need to worry about being polite or offending anybody because it's your money, so you're asking questions.
That's right.
Such as, you ask right off the bat, your first question is, how do you get paid? A commission on product sales, fee per transaction, or both? And what's the right answer on that? What's important there?
Well, I think you just need to make sure you understand that they're not in their business to give you free service. They're going to charge you for the advice they give you or the products that they sell you. And even if you decide you need a financial advisor, you need to ask them these tough questions about how they're getting paid. How are you paying for that?
Are they, does law say that they need to disclose that to you up front, or do you have to, again, just be smart enough to ask the question?
You know, that's interesting. So we had the Great Recession, mm-hmm. and Congress, in its wisdom, formed the Consumer Protection Agency, and there was a rule out of all that that said that brokers and financial planners needed to put their clients' best interest first.
Mm-hmm. I like the sound of that.
You would have thought that that would have always been the case.
No brainer.
But it's caused a lot of controversy. So they've backpedaled on that. So it's not as clear to me that they have to do that. As long as they're helping you make money, it's okay for them to also make money on whatever it is they're selling you.
Well, they have to eat too. I get that.
Well, not long ago, the Wall Street Journal had a report on how since this rule got softened up a little bit, so it's not that big a deal, the number of annuities that are being sold skyrocketed because annuities tend to have an upfront commission for the broker.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about fees. A question you have is, can you manage my assets for a 1% or less management fee?
Mm-hmm. 1% doesn't sound like a lot. But if you are taking 1% out as your financial planner is taking 1% out a year, even in down markets, that's money that's not being reinvested in your long-term funds.
Right.
And over time, a 1% fee can really add up in terms of money that's not going to you.
So would it be part of the conversation if you as a financial planner said, Pat, since you asked, my fee is 1%, would it be within my realm to be able to say, I'd be happier with 0.5 or need
absolutely
to go elsewhere?
Yeah,
and do you think there is wiggle room there with financial planners?
Yes, I think there is, especially independent ones. If you're in financial planning for the long term and for your retirement, a 0.5% management fee would be great.
Okay, yeah. I'll remember that.
Yeah.
All right, so you also said we should ask a financial planner, what's your background and experience?
Sure. My ideal financial planner would be a man or woman who's actually been in the business for 20 years. So if they started in the business, late 20s, after all their training, and mm-hmm. they have to pass tests and, all that stuff. I would want someone who's closer to 50 than anything else because they start themselves personally thinking about, well, what is retirement going to look like to me? And so you want someone that's going to take your worries seriously and that money is really important and they don't want to waste your money or get you into things that aren't the right product.
Okay. What is the strength of the company you work for? Why are we asking that?
Well, there have been fly-by-night companies that have actually gone out of business. You may know somebody around the corner that a neighbor of yours recommended. He's really great. He has his own shop and he uses blah, blah, blah. You need to know where that money's being invested, even if it's not with a big brokerage firm.
I hadn't thought of this on my own, but I know now because of Julia. What do your clients say about you? Ask for references.
Why not? Yeah. If they're not willing to do that, then you might have second thoughts about whether you want to work with them.
That makes sense. What are your checks and balances, you want to know?
Well, the checks and balances are really, maybe they shouldn't get paid unless you are making money on your money. So, do they want to put you into risky stuff and then not have to pay a penalty themselves? So there's got to be some conversation around risk versus reward. And women maybe tend to be a little bit more on the less risky side. Mm-hmm. So they've got to have a good discussion about where they want to be in terms of their investments.
Then you also hear say, will you put your proposals in writing? Is that standard or do you need to ask for that?
Well, that would be a secondary question you can ask. If they're out of the gate without really knowing who you are, wanting to sell you an annuity, I would want to see that annuity fine print in writing. And I might take it to another brokerage firm or another expert and make sure that you're buying the right thing.
Do you think if you really asked what are the potential pitfalls of the investment products you're offering, do you think they'd really tell you?
No.
Okay. Good to know. What do other professionals say about you?
I like that one a lot.
Do you get candor when you ask that, though? They say I'm too humble.
Well, the thing is, these questions are designed to get your financial advisor's attention.
I think they might.
And let them know that you actually know what the game is. And that you know that they are after your account because they want to make money on you. And so if you need that advice, how do you get it and how much are they going to charge you for it and is it worth it? And you have to keep asking yourself that over time. You know, if somebody's been doing a pretty good job for you for 5 years and then they just seem to be distracted and bored, you need to call their attention to the fact that, hey, this is my money, we need to be getting on top of this.
Well, in our family situation, we had a financial planner who has left and we've been assigned to somebody.
Ooh.
Should I ask that somebody all these questions? Wouldn't that be great?
I would.
Because just because they inherited us doesn't mean that they're going to be as good as the other person.
Well, yeah, and you need to feel really comfortable with whoever you're working with. And again, I think the age thing is a big deal. If this new person is under 30 or even, I think you need somebody who's going to be mature, you know, really be thinking about you.
Isn't that a little ageist in the anti-way?
Only in that you want someone with experience. And I think that's fair.
Okay, because it is your money and you only go around once.
Yeah.
All right, you have chapters in here. You talk about your divorce.
At 60.
Yeah.
Big surprise.
Yeah, and you learned from that things that you need to do post-divorce. And I guess what I wanted to know was, does a woman ever come out ahead financially after a divorce?
Not often. The research shows that men who divorce tend to hold on to their economic status. But women who divorce often see their lifestyle change and they really do face money challenges. Now, why is that? Well, they may have been working in a job that paid less, or they may be responsible for young children, so they can't earn as much as their ex-husband is. Also, a lot of women do not collect child support for one reason or another, and so women tend to be the losers with a divorce, so it's a big deal, and society doesn't even talk about it. But financially, it can be a real blow.
Well, and what is the figure? Half of couples get divorced. Is it still that high?
I don't think it's that high. I think the divorce rate has come down quite a bit from the 70s, but yeah, there's still plenty out there, and it's a tough one.
Do you suggest trying mediation first or go to an attorney right away?
I think it's a strictly personal situation. Mediation to stay together would be a great option if there's an opportunity to continue the marriage and preserve the financial basis of it, especially if there's young children. I think that would be a great way to go. If somebody's left with the floozy across town, and there's not a lot of hope for it, so get a good attorney and make it work.
We're going to end on an upbeat note.
Oh, please do.
We're going to talk about how post-divorce Julia met men, because you kind of went online just for a moment.
Oh, that was terrible.
And then didn't. So you have a chapter about meeting men, so tell me how you met men.
Well, this was an article in the Wall Street Journal, actually, that I gleaned some tips from, and the suggestion was to meet men the old-fashioned way, which is face-to-face. But I do have friends who have met and married men they have met on a dating site, and it's been great. It's worked out great. For me, it was friends who knew me and knew Ken and thought we'd hit it off and had a lot in common in terms of the outdoors and things we like to do, and it worked out great. So, yeah.
Well, and you have your friends looking out for you, and he has his friends looking out for him. And
they were the same friends.
If each of you passes the friends test, that's a good
right.
thing.
Right. But there is the thing about prenups, which Ken and I have. When you're over 60 and you decide to marry, and we wanted to be married, getting a prenup is a good idea. That way your kids aren't too nervous about what's going to happen to their inheritance.
All right, we are out of time, but it's in the book, so
yeah.
You can read about it in the book. Where can people get the book, Julia?
Amazon.com, easy. Just search for the book title and my name and you'll find it. Or at my website, 60andsingle.com, there's a buy button there.
All right, Smart Women, Smart Money, Smart Life, written by Julia Anderson, host of this show. I'm Pat Boyle. It's my pleasure to be with you today, and you as well, author Julia Anderson.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
For more information, go to my website at 60andsingle.com.